Hey guys, I'm Jackie Brubaker. I'm an author, a motivational and career coach, and host of That Girl, the podcast. Each week, I bring on a leader in their field to talk about how to stop making excuses and how you can start living your lifelong dream. That Girl, the podcast is based on That Girl, the novel, which is on Amazon to download or buy the paperback of. To find books, courses, and products from our episodes, check out the shop page at thatgirlcoaching.com. You can also follow us on Instagram at Jackie Brubaker and at That Girl, the podcast, and our Patreon page. Welcome, Melissa Vine, to That Girl, the podcast. I'm very excited to have you on today. We are going to talk about some heavy stuff, but mainly we're going to talk about narcissism with your ex-husband and with men. And that is a word that gets thrown around a lot, but there's a lot to know about it. There's a lot to learn about it. I think a lot of people are in narcissistic relationships and they don't realize they are. So today we're really just going to show your story and get people more aware of helping themselves and helping others. So what I like to do, I always like to let people introduce themselves because they can always do a better version than I can. So please introduce yourself.
Sure. Yeah. So happy to be here. And I come to this with a professional and a personal angle. So my background is grew up in a very conservative home. And so I started with that patriarchal model, and we'll probably get into a little bit more of that later on. But so transitioning into the career world from that place of being a stay-at-home homeschooling mom for children to going back and getting my master's in mental health counseling, working as a mental health counselor. And then during grad school, I worked as a victim advocate for victims of domestic violence and sexual assault. And learned a lot myself because I was coming out of domestic violence and sexual assault in my marriage as well. And so then after I finished getting my full licensure, my LMHC letters, I decided I needed something a little more macro. So I am the executive director at Beacon of Life, which is a nonprofit that helps women coming out of incarceration, domestic violence, substance use, whatever kind of trauma just has them where they are struggling to maintain stable housing and employment. We provide housing as well as wraparound programming services to help them truly get back on their feet. And so I do that. And in the meantime, I started two businesses. I've sold one of them, and then the other one, I acquired a business and then I sold off part of it. So I still have the speaking and consulting piece of it, but that's kind of been my some side hustles to recover from the financial damage that divorcing a narcissist can do. So So it's I would say the last couple of years have been really great. Things kind of coming to fruition after many years of many, many dark days. So I'm in a really great place now and happy to talk about my story and help others who may be at different places in their journey. So
absolutely. And I think just having a light at the end of the tunnel, and that's you, for some people is so important. They just want to know like, oh, she can get out of it too. Like, I can do this. I can start over again. And they do not make it easy for you to start over again. So let's go back to, you grew up in a conservative home. It was a religious home. What religion were you?
So it was Christian. Growing up more Lutheran Missouri Synod, but then got into more evangelicalism when I met my ex-husband. So,
Okay. And so, like you said, like, you know, it's a very patriarchal kind of environment. It's very like, you know, the man is the leader of the household. And how did you feel about that even when you were growing up? Did you ever agree with that? Or were you like, yeah, no, like lead for us. It's okay.
It wasn't verbally acknowledged as much in the environment that I grew up in. I would say it more when I met my ex-husband and his family, and the churches that they attended, the circles they were in, it was something that was discussed, verbally out loud. Whereas prior to that, I think it was just sort of this unspoken, this is the way it is, which might be true even for folks who aren't Christian, just the impact of culture and such. Sure. So in my family, we looked really good on the outside, right? So mom got us all dressed up nice for church, and mom led Bible school. Dad was a church elder. We were good kids. You know, one of our siblings had a disability, and so people just kind of saw us as this like model middle-class white family. But you know, my father is actually a sex predator, and has committed I couldn't even count how many criminal and just inappropriate types of acts, but we weren't aware of this at the time. And so I think that the patriarchal model helped to protect him, because he was in that position of power. And when women in that type of environment, if something seems off or something's not right, a lot of times the response is that perhaps the woman can do something to make things better, mm-hmm. as opposed to looking at who the actual perpetrator might be.
Right. I think it's so easy for women to be like, oh gosh, should I bring this on? Sometimes, mm-hmm. or absolutely, like, I can fix this. I can love him better. He's just broken. Yeah, sure, he's broken, but like, you can't fix that.
Right.
Yeah. So, okay. So you don't know that your dad is a predator. He never preyed on you?
Nope. No, I mean, he was physically and verbally abusive to me, mm-hmm. but there was no, there was no sexual abuse that God. I know of with my father. Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. Thank God. So what age were you when you found that out?
Actually the fullness of it has been just this year, to be honest, but there were definitely bits and pieces, knew that there were definitely problematic behaviors along the way, infidelity, and some strange behaviors had kind of slipped out into the public, but so many things were hidden that it wasn't until recently that it became really obvious the depth of the issue. And I think a lot of that stemmed from the accessibility with online, the ability to exploit women online. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so ironically, my father was donating to the organization where I work, which helps women who are victims of sexual exploitation, while at the same time exploiting women from similar organizations in town, at the exact same time. It's really quite interesting.
He felt incredibly guilty, I think. Maybe?
You know, I think that because of his narcissistic tendencies, I'm not sure that his heart, mind allows him to go there.
Yeah, I agree. That is so interesting. I just watched this thing on Red Table Talk, actually, and they were talking to a man who thinks he's a narcissist, but he's not quite sure. He is also, by the way, just he is. But he's kind of a little bit more aware. And I thought it was an interesting article or interview, because he's like kind of like the window's kind of open for him to see it, but it's also like, what am I looking at? Not sure. And it's fascinating. Wow. So I kind of feel like maybe, who knows, but you know, maybe your dad was like, I know I'm probably not doing the right thing. However, I'm not going to stop doing it because I want to do it. But I also feel like maybe I'll keep donating and maybe like, you know, God will absolve me of my sins.
I mean, to maintain a narcissistic lifestyle requires a tremendous amount of manipulation, mm-hmm. and both of yourself, because first you have to convince yourself that what you're doing is okay, right?
Absolutely.
And most of us would not have the capacity to convince ourselves that that kind of behavior was okay. And that's where most of us are like, yeah, I couldn't even go there because I couldn't manipulate myself that much.
Right.
And then it's manipulating the people around you. So even someone who is like, for instance, this person you're talking about that's saying, oh yeah, I might be a narcissist. Even saying that could be a form of manipulation to continue behaviors. I mean, it is like every time my father would go to some kind of counseling or retreat or what, you know, whatever it was, he just came back with more arsenal to be manipulative, really.
Absolutely.
More Bible verses to use, more speeches to give of self-loathing. And so I think for me, this is true of a lot of domestic violence victims. I tend to assume the best about people, mm-hmm. and trust easily. Mm-hmm. And so when he would say, oh gosh, I'm realizing how much I've hurt you and how much I need to change, I believed it every time, even if it was the 10th time he had told me that.
Sure. I know. Go on.
And so for me, I had to educate myself on the nature of domestic violence and the nature of narcissism, both to understand my father and his capacity for manipulation, mm-hmm. as well as to understand the situation with my ex-husband.
Right.
And so, I was going to say the book that helped me the most was called Why Does He Do That? Ooh. And it's so good because it's written by a man who's worked with abusive men for over 15 years. And he gives such a clear characterization of the different types of abuse and what it's going to look like and explains how these men know what they're doing because they call each other out on the behaviors. I mean, it was fascinating and it just opened my eyes to how much women or victims have been played, really.
Absolutely. It is so true. I mean, there has to be an empath or someone who is trusting, and then it just brings a narcissist. It's like they hear it. It's like radar. They just find you and you're like, whoa. Yes. I'm asking so much about your dad because, of course, that was the, you know, preview of like coming attractions.
And right?
You were already prepared to fall for a narcissist. Let's just, for someone who is maybe confused on what this means, maybe they've just heard the word a lot, but they're not quite sure what that means. Can you kind of simply spell out what a narcissist looks like sort of in daylight?
Yeah, I think that's a great question to ask because, as you said, it does get thrown around a lot. And just in everyday culture. And I think sometimes it's misunderstood to be the person who takes lots of selfies or the person who's very grandiose. And those things, I mean, someone who's very grandiose, that can be a trait of narcissism. But the key trait to understanding if someone is narcissistic is what is their capacity for empathy? Mm-hmm. And so there's sort of this slippery slope where we all struggle with empathy at various points in various situations. If our shame trigger gets hit, we might struggle with empathy. That's for sure. As that starts to slide off down that slope, you start to get into abusive behaviors. And then you get into more like a pattern of abuse. And I would say someone who is abusive, as opposed to all of us can commit abusive behaviors. But when you become an abusive person, you're sliding down that slope. And then kind of down there at the bottom is narcissism, where it's just a complete lack of empathy. And I would say folks who are abusive have varying levels of empathy, but definitely someone who's narcissistic has zero or close to zero capacity to understand the world from someone else's perspective. So if I say to a narcissistic person, that hurt me, is their response going to come from a place of, oh, I've caused pain. I need to explore that and figure out what did I do and how did I impact this person? Or is it going to come from a place of, oh, I want this person to still like me or sleep with me or say nice things about me or give me the raise. So I'm going to say X, Y, Z in order to stay in good graces with them. So that's where it can sound like they have empathy. But where is that? Where is that actually coming from? What is their motivation, their end goal? And so I tend to see, as a therapist and in my personal life, a couple of different kinds of narcissists. And one is the one that you might think of first. That's a very flamboyant personality. They like to put themselves at the center. They might dress really nice, be really successful, have lots of women. They're kind of flashy, right? But then there's also this pervading sense of narcissism among some folks who are more quiet.
Oh, completely.
They might keep to themselves. They might not be super social. They might not shine the spotlight on themselves, mm-hmm. but they feel very threatened by other people who have the spotlight shined on them. Mm-hmm. Or if in a relationship, they feel very threatened if the partner has needs or the partner expresses a concern about the narcissistic person's behavior, if they try to hold them accountable.
Right.
Those are when you see those narcissistic behaviors come out, because it really gets back to, do they have empathy? There's not one personality type that is narcissistic, because it can be a variety of personality types. And I think that's where people get confused, because those quiet abusive people and narcissistic people don't come across right away as narcissistic.
No, they absolutely don't. And those are, to me, I think the ones to be most afraid of, because you're just, you don't see them coming. You think, oh, wow, what a nice person, or what a, you know, they're just well, what they really are is antisocial when you're saying they're quiet to themselves. I'm like, no, they probably have antisocial disorder. And that's the beginning. Also, you know, there are definitely different levels of narcissism. There can be like way off the scale, like major narcissist. And then there can be people with narcissistic traits. And it does vary, but the lack of empathy is the number one thing. Things that narcissists do. And then I want to get into your story with your husband, your ex-husband, very clearly ex-husband. there's a couple things that they do. So for people who are in a relationship and they're wondering, am I with a narcissist? It's again, like you said, it is not just like, oh, it's all about me. Cause they're deeply insecure individuals. They may seem that they are not, and they may seem that they know everything and that they're right about everything, but that's just because they're deeply, deeply insecure. So this facade that they have, the whole wolf in sheep's clothing scenario, is really so tight with them. They are so afraid of actually being seen for who they are. So just like what you said, when you start to call them out on their actions or like, why are you doing this? They're like, I'm not doing anything wrong. Like you can't see this, but then those cracks start to happen. And then that's where the abuse really starts to amp up, whether it's gaslighting just to begin with, which is for those of you who don't know what that is, gaslighting is when you say to them, you said blah, 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 blah. And they did. They said it. And then they say, no, I didn't. No, you're crazy. Like, I never did that. I never said that. And you're like, no, you definitely did that. No, I didn't. No, you're remembering it wrong. This is how it went. And it's just this round and round thing of, no, you're definitely wrong. And I'm definitely right because I don't want you to see that I was a bad person ever.
Or so they explain why they said it with a reason that puts you as the bad person.
Absolutely.
Like, well, I had to say that because you did this.
Absolutely. You are always wrong. So if you're in a relationship, you're always wrong. Sign number one. Okay. Red flag number one. You're always wrong. You're not stupid. You're not dumb. They're manipulating you. The other thing too is stonewalling. I was with a narcissist and that man would fight me to the death or he would stonewall me.
Oh.
And it was so hard. So stonewalling, I'll just give a definition. You take it over. Stonewalling, I'm actually being stonewalled by my father right now, which is really fun.
Oh.
So yeah, I'm like, oh.
Sorry to hear that.
That's okay. Thank you. I'm like, well, this is fun. Let's just ride this out. And I mean, I've set my boundary and it's like, and this is what's happening. Anyway, stonewalling is when they literally don't talk to you. They literally stonewall you. They don't talk to you. They don't look at you. It's like you don't exist. I'm sure you had this in your marriage where like you're living in a house together, but it's as if no one else is there with you. And you're like, hello, like, can we talk about this? And they're like, I don't even see you. You don't exist. Now, again, like all of us can have moments where we're like, I don't want to talk to you, but it's different. It's a different level of intensity. So talk about some stonewalling stuff that maybe I didn't cover.
Actually, that was really great to bring that up. And actually, in my situation, and I think a lot of because of my background coming into it, I didn't understand the concept of boundaries. And I'd been married for probably, 9 years-ish. And I had a new friend and she became my best friend. And she started hanging out around my house more and kind of started seeing some things. And she was teaching me about what boundaries were. And this was a new concept to me because I thought, like, I believe that, like, I should do everything that he wanted, just bend over backwards, whatever he wanted. So the first time I implemented a boundary, I'll never forget. And it was about, I mean, we're talking like 10 years in our relationship, right? And it was the first time that I like stood up for myself. And he wanted me to drive across the state with 4 children, like 5 and under, like little kids, drive across the state, pack up all their food and stay in his parents' lake house where the kitchen's not stocked. So I would have to bring things for everybody. We were going to go stay there for one night and then drive all the way back.
What?
And he was going to, he had a job in that town. We owned a garage door company. He had a job in that town, but he was only going to get back to the lake house at bedtime. He was just basically going to sleep there. That was it. But he just wanted me to be there with him. And historically, I would have, I had done that before lots of times, and I would have been like, yeah, sure. You know, that's, I had to be the cheerful Christian wife, right? And mm-hmm. so, but this time I was like, okay, I just started learning about boundaries, and I was like, okay, I'm so excited and nervous. And I was like, I'm going to put up a boundary. I was like, here I go. Here we go. And so I was like, ooh, sweating. I was so nervous. And I was like, I don't think that makes sense for me to do that. I don't think that the benefit of that outweighs the amount of work and effort that it would take. And that was my first major experience with the stonewalling because I had put that boundary and he did not like it. So I had that silent treatment for several days. And then eventually I felt so guilty that I didn't actually go, but I did kind of, you know, would come around and be like, I'm sorry. I'm sorry that upset you. And we kind of had this cycle that often went like that, where I would try to like push through and keep being cheerful and keep doing what he want. And then after a while I would just like cry and I'd be like, oh, this marriage is so hard. How am I going to do it? And then I'd get in my Bible and read my book that I had that talked all about submission, and I'd get all fired up again. Okay, here I go. I can do this.
Right.
You know, so yeah.
Yeah, no. Well, actually the word submission. So I've had a couple of conversations with different people, one of which was a podcast, and she was brought up in the evangelical church, she's a evangelical. Uh-huh. Anyway, she couldn't stand that word. I can't stand that word either. And I can understand parts of it from different angles now, but I mean, essentially what it kind of comes off as is you're just supposed to do whatever your husband wants because that's your husband and then that's it. And it's so, I think it's very confusing. I've also heard other definitions of it, which is not that. It's really just... Actually, what is your definition of it? Because I'd be very interested to know.
Well, I think it's just like you're submitting to someone's leadership, to someone's authority, basically. Mm-hmm. And I think what you said is right on. I can remember so the first time I separated from him, that was actually his please take me back speech was the Bible says you have to submit to me and I want you to make me happy. And that was literally what he said. And historically that would have worked. And it really did make it hard for me to continue on that path. Because when I separated from him, I did not believe that what I was doing was okay. So I had some major cognitive dissonance happening where I was making this decision to separate when on the other side of my head, I had this Bible verse that said a woman should not separate from her husband. And I'm like, this goes against everything I've ever believed or taught, all the things. And I had an incredible amount of guilt. But the important thing with guilt is to explore it and figure out, is this false guilt or this real guilt? Mm-hmm. And that's a whole other path to go down. But yeah.
I think when we are trying to do things we've never done before, it feels uncomfortable. And Maybe this is wrong. This is so hard. This can't be, if it's wrong, it should be, you know, or if it's right, it should be easy. And when you set boundaries, it is the most uncomfortable thing because most likely you've never set boundaries in your life. And so now it's like, wait, I'm supposed to say no to people? Like,
oh my goodness,
I want to say yes. I want to please. I want to be there for people. And that's what's awful about this dynamic of like empaths and narcissists is that when you're empathic, you just want to give. You love giving. It makes you feel so happy. I can absolutely understand how you felt like as this like, you know, just devoted wife who's like, I'm going to do everything right. And it feels so good, right? Because we're like usually rule followers. Like we like rules. Like, no. Uh-huh. Everything right. And it feels so good because I checked it off my list.
Yes.
And then you're like, oh, wait. This isn't really actually working. Why isn't this working? Is it me? First of all, it's like, is it me? But it's probably me. Let me make sure it's not me. And then you realize it's not you and that the situation is just really, really flawed. I'm absolutely not saying that, like, you know, if you are in a Christian marriage and like it's, you know, not working, that it's because you're Christian or anything like that. I really think that it's just the people. It has everything to do with the people and like the rules in their marriage of what is okay and what's not okay. So you've set this first boundary, and then what happens after that? How does it kind of progress?
Yeah. So I continue to experiment with more boundaries and then We ended up moving an hour away, and one of our businesses that we owned was growing, and it was about an hour away. So I thought maybe if we cut down on the commute time, that would help with our marriage. And so it was kind of a last ditch effort. But what that did was it isolated me even more from my support system. Right. Thankfully my best friend did move as well, and she actually managed our businesses, but
wow,
which is a whole nother complication because, As I implemented more boundaries, because that learning was coming from my best friend, she became the scapegoat. So she became the one who was blamed by both my ex-husband and the church and other social support systems, that she must have been the one that was turning me into this. I remember he said, "You used to always just be so nice and so bubbly, and now you're mean," you know, because those boundaries, for someone who's abusive or narcissistic, boundaries are interpreted as mean-spirited, right? Because someone who is abusive or narcissistic, they have this alternate universe, and there is this rotation around that universe, and they have their partner and sometimes other folks pulled into that rotation. And as long as you play by their rules, you don't have or express any needs, and you don't hold them accountable for any behavior, that orbit just keeps going. You're in that orbit. But as soon as you start to get pulled away to the actual universe that I call reality,
yes,
you get a glimpse of that, whether it be a friend or a family member, or you read something and you're like, wait a minute, your eyes start to open up a little bit. Wait a minute. Mm-hmm. I think I'm living in an alternate reality. And even if you can't define it at that as initially, you start to see that there's something else. Mm-hmm. And as you get pulled away into that, of course, this person who's abusive and is at the center of this alternate universe is going to be freaking out because they've had you in their orbit, and you're starting to go into this other orbit. And it's like, wait a minute, you're supposed to revolve around me.
Right.
So as the boundary setting increased on my part, and I'm getting pulled into reality and pulled away from his orbit of control, he's freaking out more and more. So of course the abuse is increasing. Mm-hmm. Right. And then it became a little bit more physically scary toward the end. But by that point, you love this person so much. At least I loved him so much that I couldn't possibly interpret some of those abusive behaviors for what they actually were.
Right.
Because love can make things really confusing.
Right. Do you think you were, looking back, do you think you were really in love with him at that point? Or do you think that you were sort of in love with the idea of what you guys had been?
You know, I do think that I loved him. I get attached pretty intensely. I have a pretty intense personality, no surprise, but I actually loved him, I would say, probably for about 3 years after we got divorced. Even I had to go back to therapy because I was like, what is going on? And my therapist was like, do you still love him? And I just started bawling because I was like, oh my gosh. And I was, at first, of course, I was like, no. And I was like, oh my gosh, I do. And so then I had to, you know, work through that, because my love for him presented as pain and anger. Okay. But the reason I had so much pain and anger was because I loved him. If I didn't love him, if I didn't care about that relationship, I wouldn't feel that pain so intensely. You see people coming out of those relationships and you see the hatred or the pain, you see those really strong negative emotions, but actually what's typically behind that is love. Because if you didn't love that person, you wouldn't care what they thought of you. If it was some stranger on the street, I don't care how they treat me. I'm going to go on my life and never see them again. Right. So I had a lot of big feelings to work through. When I got divorced, I very much still wanted to be married and love him. And I wanted it to work. I did not get divorced because I didn't love him anymore. I got divorced because I wasn't safe.
Right. And that's what keeps people in abusive marriages and abusive relationships, is that they do love them. They really genuinely do, but they're being abused mentally, physically, emotionally, all of the above. Mm-hmm. And what do you think is it, what is it that actually gets people to leave? What was the final straw for you?
I think that reality orbit has to be more appealing than the alternate reality. Mm-hmm. And in order for me to believe, in order for me to believe that reality is true, over in reality are truths like, I'm a lovable person. I have value apart from my performance. Mm-hmm. I can trust myself. I can trust my feelings. Those are all truths over here in reality,
right,
that are not true in this alternate reality. And having people in my life that spoke that truth into my life and reading books that emphasize that truth and going to grad school and learning about mental health and just confirming the truth that when I feel bad, I can trust that feeling. And that is not me just trying to excuse, you know, oh, I just want to treat people this way and that's why I feel bad. No, like I actually do feel bad and I can trust that and that, that feeling. And I can believe that I'm worth being loved. And I think the more you pull into that reality, that actual reality where those truths exist, then people that are in these alternate realities, you start to see more clearly and they just become less appealing. The people you want in your life are people that treat you in the same way that you would treat yourself.
Right. I think that's so true. And it just takes time, you know, it's not an overnight thing. And I think that's part of why, you know, a lot of people say like, well, if it's so bad, why don't you leave? And I hate that question because it's clearly coming from someone who's never experienced it. The manipulation is deep and it takes a long time to create that kind of codependent bond that you guys have, you know?
Yeah.
And it's not just as easy, especially if you're married and you have kids and a whole life together. I mean, you're already intertwined so much, but even if you didn't have all of that, it is so confusing. I just remember being so incredibly confused. Like, I keep standing up for myself, but he won't go away. Like, why won't he leave me alone? Like, why won't he leave my life? And it was so hard to get him away from me. But then when he would kind of like sort of pretend to leave a little bit, I would be like, you know, maybe I'm overreacting. Like, maybe this is just what a relationship is. Like, maybe it's just different now. I'm older. Maybe this is what it is. And you totally can tell make yourself believe something just to make a relationship work. And, there's a lot of pressure to stay in it, especially if you're a certain age or whatever. Like the whole thing is just so, so convoluted.
And how they present to the world can be very different than how they present in a relationship. Completely. So other people can be like, well, this is such a great guy. Like, why would you, you know, but let me challenge us all with this. Can we change the question from why didn't you leave to why did he keep abusing? Right. Because the question we ask is focused on the victim and these responsibilities we're putting on the victim.
Right.
Let's put the responsibility on the abuser. Whenever you hear that question get asked, I always switch it back to people. Why didn't he quit abusing? Why didn't they quit abusing? And I think too, that cycle of abuse is a really powerful illustration of why it can make it really difficult to get out. So, you know, there's the first stage that's the wooing and putting you on a pedestal. I remember that stage really well. Mm-hmm. And you feel initially, you know, that you feel like a million bucks, like, wow. And typically, you know, when I was in a place where I was really insecure, just infusing tons of positive messages into my life just had a huge impact on how I felt. So right. I felt really good. And then you have that tension building phase where things start to get a little bit, it's a little bit emotionally unstable. Some starting to see some little signs, and then the acting out phase. And that's where something more significantly abusive happens, whether it be emotional, verbal, physical, sexual. And that's when typically then the partner, the victim pulls away a bit, right? So then the abuser knows to keep that manipulation going to go back to the wooing stage. And that's where I'm sorry, the flowers, I'm going to, you know, do whatever religious thing you want me to do. I'm going to read this book. I'm going to go to counseling. Right. And so what happens is, you know, when someone gets to the point when they're like, okay, that's it, I'm leaving. And then the abuser goes back into that wooing stage. It's like, well, okay, maybe they're changing. Right. And again, if these are folks like me who tend to trust and believe the best about people, it's like, oh, okay. I mean, I can remember we separated in 2012. And we were separated for 6 weeks, and he turned into this completely different person I had never seen before. And I was like, wow, this is amazing. This works so well. Come on home. And it was like, you know, the minute he came back home, it was right back to the tension building phase. And then we started going through the cycle again. I just didn't know. And then it was 2014 when separated again and then filed for divorce. But I didn't know that cycle existed or that I was a pawn in his game.
Right. Well, and they do just use you as fuel, you know, they're like, ooh, you're making me feel so good about myself because you're in my orbit and you're doing what I want you to do. And you're so pretty and you're so this and you're so that, you make me look even better. Like I felt so used in that way too. And I know a lot of people do. It's like, oh, look at this beautiful girl on my arm. Like, I'm so like, look at how great I am. And the thing is, like, being in that orbit and then also being through those like cycles of abuse, I remember saying like all the time, I'm like, I feel like I'm in the Twilight Zone. I literally feel like I'm in the Twilight Zone right now. Like, why does nothing make sense? But it makes sense to me, but it doesn't like make sense when I actually like implement anything.
And that's
just in regular conversation. I thought this was funny too. I just remember this as you were talking, how, and I'm only giving examples because like, it's important for other people to hear it. I would start to do everything he would want me to do. And then he would hate it. Like you would think he would be like, oh, great. But no, he would actually start to resent me for it and get mad at me. So I was like, I actually don't know what you want me to do anymore. Like, do you want me to be like this or do you not? Like, it was total crazy making. I can't believe like over the smallest things too. It wasn't even like big stuff all the time. It was tiny, tiny weird things. I'm like, you're crazy. Yeah, it was a fun ride, but I mean, luckily it was only a one-time situation, but it also starts from like, you know, parents, like your dad was obviously a narcissist and like you learned some of that behavior. So it felt normal when you met your husband to be like, oh, this feels familiar.
Yeah. I mean, I think the coping mechanism that becomes normalized is denial, you know, and that goes back to that. When I have those bad feelings, I'm not paying attention to them. I'm not believing them. Instead, I'm believing what this person who's manipulative is telling me is the truth.
Right.
Yeah.
What advice would you give someone if they are like, I am in an abusive relationship, he is a narcissist, or he's just abusive? I mean, either or. And I want to get out, but you know, we give ourselves all of these excuses. Like it's a money thing. It's a kid thing. It's a location thing. It's a this. Like, what would you tell someone on how to take some steps to move forward when they feel like they don't have a lot of choices?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I erroneously assumed that when we went through divorce that he would be fair with our finances.
what a wonderful idea.
Unfortunately, I'm going to warn folks that it probably will, you'll see an even worse side of someone that you thought was already,
because you'll see the real side of them. Then the monster will truly appear and you'll be like, oh my God,
you are like, there's a lot more in there that you were holding a lot back.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah. So I went from, we were pretty well off. And I went from, you know, wealth to absolute poverty, like literally overnight. And I was on food stamps and I had four little children. I was finishing grad school and then I hadn't had a job in 10 years. I'd been a stay-at-home mom, so I had no resume. And we lived on about $1,500 a month for about 2 years, and $950 of it went toward my mortgage.
Rest
of it was utilities, internet, you know, groceries, toiletries, school activities, clothing. I mean, all of that for me and four kids had to fit in $550 a month. I was insane. And I don't know how we made it. I don't think I could do that again.
Right. No, of course.
But, and also, you know, being alone with four children and then he hasn't paid child support in over 5 years. And so, which is par for the course, right? But so I will say that had I known what I was getting into, I'm not sure I could have done it. But so this is terrible. I'm giving terrible advice so far. I'm telling you how scary it is.
Just leave anyway.
But but I made it, right? So now I have a master's degree. I'm running a nonprofit. I have my LMHC. I just got a full ride to law school. So I'm going to law school this summer. So I mean, I like, there were probably 5 to 7 really, really dark years, like really dark, really hard. But I will say that now where I'm at now, I could have never been even close to here had I stayed in that marriage. And so being able to put up with short-term discomfort with that long-term goal in mind was everything for me. And I think what helped me a lot was a couple of things: educating myself. So I read books like Why Does He Do That? Or other books that talk about abuse, because as you read it, it pulls you into that reality, right? And it opens your eyes to the ways you've been in this alternate reality. And the more you can have a clear sense of what this relationship is or was, the easier it is to heal, because you realize, oh, I'm not this terrible person that I've been made out to be, that I actually can trust myself and I can trust my feelings and I am worth loving. So it pulls you into that reality, but also, of course, having a support system. And if you have people in your life that when you talk about your relationship and they become judgy, or they ask you questions, they turn things on you, they seem to, you go away from the conversation feeling worse, those probably aren't the kind of people that you want for your support team. And if you can't find a support team, then pursue professional support team and or both, right? Because that's, I think therapists, I went to several years of therapy myself, even when I was a therapist, and that was amazing, you know, that was super helpful. So
yeah, no, therapy is such a good thing. And there's so many great Facebook groups. I know I've got a Facebook group, That Girl Coaching. Do you have a Facebook group that people are?
I don't yet. No.
You need to get yourself a group. It is fun.
I took social media off my phone.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
Yeah. That's a whole thing. I don't know.
I get it. It can be really intense. But no, that is really good advice. If you're with people who are trying to keep you stuck in an abusive situation, because maybe they're in an abusive situation and they don't want you to leave that orbit with them. Yes. I'm talking friends who are like, no, stay in your unhealthy marriage with me, please, because I'm not ready to leave either. Don't be friends with them. Like, it's important to cut the fat, even if you care about that person. Like, you are still number one. You know, even when you have kids, like, you are still number one because you're taking care of them, right? So, like, you have to swim, and you cannot sink with these people who are terrible influences or stuck in their own orbit that you are coming out of. So yeah, I mean, I agree with you. It is much better to have short-term, you know, discomfort than being in something for the rest of your life where you're like, well, now it's 20 years of pure misery. And
you know what? My mom is finally getting divorced from my father as of this year. And I see they separated for the first time when I was in junior high. I think of all the pain and trauma my mom has been through in the recent decades. And she wasn't in a place yet where she had the information and support she needed to get out at that time, I don't think. But, you know, I look at her now and she's in her 60s, you know, and I'm so thankful that I got out in my 30s. Yeah. I just turned 40. I'm like, okay, I'm halfway dead, but I've got half my life left.
I'm turning 40 this year too. You're not halfway dead. I'm living till like 90 something.
I'm fine. We'll just speak truth. Okay. Maybe a little less than halfway. We'll see. I don't know. But, I feel like, gosh, I still have half my life ahead of me, I think. And I'm so thankful that I did the work when I did, and I got out when I did, because there are so many good things happening in my life now and so many good things ahead. And so
I agree. I hope that people listening, this is very helpful and helps them get one step closer to leaving a bad abusive relationship. You mentioned the book, Why Does He Do This? What other books would you suggest?
Oh,
or even websites?
I think Glennon Doyle's books are really good, and Brené Brown, and Maya Angelou. I think people that speak truth, women that speak truth, and they're authentic, because abusive relationships take away authenticity. And I think authenticity is what makes us so beautiful as humans. And you lose that in an abusive relationship. You become a shell of yourself. And so reading books by women who are their authentic selves, I think is just so empowering and healing.
Absolutely. All right. Well, tell people how they can find you, because you are very special and they want to find you, I'm sure.
Thank you. I'm at melissavine.com. So MelissaVine.com. And I also chose that last name when I got divorced. So that's kind of a cool story too. So
you tell the story. Now I need to know the story.
Well, I mean, just that, like, I'm like, you know what? I could go back to my maiden name, but even my maiden name is patriarchal, right? This is based on my father. And I'm not saying it's wrong for anyone to do that, but I was like, I'm my own person and I'm going to build my own life and I want to choose a name and it's going to be my name until I die. And which I'm halfway there, like I said. So
it's going really well.
Plus I'm like, hey, I want to get a lot of letters behind my name. So I need something short.
I love that. Oh my goodness. And why Vine? Why the word Vine?
Well, so I'm no longer a Christian, but I do appreciate some of the imagery from the Bible and the concept in John 15 of staying connected to the vine. And I think that can be true for anyone, just spiritually speaking, to stay connected to each other and connected to truth. And that happens through that image of a vine. So
I love that. I love that. Everybody go find melissavine.com. And yeah, thank you so much for coming on and sharing your story. It's so much fun to talk to you and to just get more awareness out there.
Well, thank you for hearing it and for sharing your own as well.